Tent City, and this Tent City is in Lakewood, New Jersey. The camp is about 7 years old. It's one of the largest tent cities on the East Coast of America, and it's got about 100 people here. It's very diverse, racially diverse, culturally diverse. All the old reasons, the traditional reasons for homelessness. You've got alcoholism, you got mental illness, you've got other types of addiction. You know, but now we've got people here just because of economics, solely because of economics. The cost of housing in this area especially is very high. It takes 3 minimum wage jobs for a single individual to afford the basic necessities of life. If this is public land and we're part of the public, and they've created an environment where we can't afford a place to live, I believe as an American, we have a right to camp out or to possess public land until something is created.
It might appear that Tent City is, you know, everybody is just, you know, drinking or, you know, causing problems for each other, and that we're expecting government handouts. That's not the case. It's the first line of attack from people who don't like Tent City or from people who don't like the homeless. The first line, get a job, you bum. That's the line, right? That's not the case. Most of the people work here. I have a full-time job. A lot of people have full-time jobs, and I still can't afford a home. That's why I'm here. I'm an overnight clerk. There's a shop right about a mile up the road. I work overnight stock, and I bag. Just gotta take what I can get, you know? I work full-time, make my paycheck, put it in the bank, and I save it. I still live in a tent. I'm not any sort of government assistance. I make too much money. So because I work full time, I'm too rich. You have to make less than a certain amount of money, and it depends on your household, the number of people in your house. It's just me, I'm not married, no kids. So for me, the money that I make, I'm too wealthy. I do qualify for food stamps. I can get about $42 a month in food stamps. It's on a sliding scale. The maximum for one person is $200 a month, and the minimum, I think, is about $20 a month, depending on how much money you make. So because I work full-time, I'm too rich to get welfare or temporary rent assistance or general assistance where they just give you a check for $140 a month. So I'm too wealthy. Go figure. I'm too wealthy. That's my house. You see it back there? I live in a tent. I'm too wealthy to get general assistance. You tell me this works out? This is right? This isn't the way America's supposed to be. Okay, it's unbalanced. You have hardworking, upstanding citizens who can't afford homes.
You know, 30 years, 35 years. We lived in New York for 35 years. And we've been vegetarian, vegan, and we rescue animals. When we lived in New York City, we spent tens of thousands of dollars rescuing birds. Believe it or not, tens of thousands of dollars rescuing birds. If we hadn't done that, we wouldn't have been homeless. We would have had what do they call it, a nest, you know what I mean? We would have had security money. But I don't regret it, because we saved so many wonderful lives.
Yeah, I was in the textile industry for 35 years, and it just pretty much has all been outsourced to China. The industry was very large, mostly New York-based.
It was designing for fabrics, prints primarily, but some wovens too, for furniture. And I kind of sort of went up the ladder into management, and I was a design director in my biggest years. I guess I was managing like 20 artists.
You did mention that your design sold for millions of dollars and you received...
pennies on the dollar.
Pennies on the dollar.
Now, literally, two patterns that I did for my boss, like as an emergency project, they had to be done right now so that he could get this account. They made each of them, actually there were three of them, they each made $1.5 million a year for 2 years. Just those three patterns, not counting everything else I did. I was really quite successful. Believe it or not.
So, there's a lot of reasons why people end up in Tent City. But again, I don't ask any questions. When they come down here and they say, I have no place to stay, we'll give them a tent, just give them some basic rules. And the fundamental rule is respect your neighbor, get along with your neighbor. And for the most part, they do. The community is quite quite good about getting along with each other.
Bert, come here. Bert, don't you get... Bert, I cannot run. Go.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Turkey!
It's
better than milk.
Okay, here you go.
Exactly.
I want this, though.
Well,
this is what I want.
Can you reach that?
This is what I want. I got it. Let me do it. Thank you.
She's got it.
And it's backwards. That's why I couldn't get it open.
Oh, those are good.
Yeah, they are. The hummus.
So is all this food being donated?
Yeah, this comes from a high-end warehouse in a neighboring town, not too far from here, maybe 3 miles. And what it is when it gets close to the date, the expiration date, they can't send it out to their people, so they donate. They get a tax write-off on the things that they donate. So it benefits us. It's still, in date, very close to date, but in date. And it's a tremendous benefit for the homeless. Thing is, we eat good, but we still don't have a place to live,
Hey, with your girl. I know it's good. Mm-hmm. So again, good for you. Mm-hmm. You want no pickles with it?
Mm-hmm. I tried one. I didn't like them. Yeah.
You feel good.
Okay. Well, I pretty much came here because we had an apartment and we were $200 short of for our apartment, and they evicted us. All of our stuff got taken away from us and everything, and we wound it up here. And ever since then, Minister Steve has been a blessing to us. He opened up his arms to us.
I never wanted to make a career of being homeless. some people like get into it and they like it, and that's what they want to do because it's free rent. They don't have to pay rent. They have no worries. I mean, if you can vicariously survive like that, that's their thing. But me personally, I like stability in life.
You coming? Okay, I'm on board. I'm on board. Okay.
So these are the townspeople. It's basically a cross section of the poor of the community. They'll come out and whatever I have. They have no idea what I'm bringing usually. Sometimes it's clothes, sometimes it's food. So a lot of times we'll get things donated by companies. And so it's a benefit. Whatever I get, I just give out freely, never charge. A lot of these people, especially the Spanish, the Mexican population, a lot of them are living in overcrowded conditions, slumlord conditions, bad plumbing, bad electricity, wires running all over the place, crowded into small spaces, doing whatever they can to secure their housing. A lot of it's substandard housing, and they're scraping by.
Was grace that taught my heart to sing, and grace my fears relieve. How sweet the hour, the power.
Our that I first believed.
Some nice little huevos. Huevos? I don't think any of this is subsidized. I think the people are, you know, paying for this out of their own pocket. And again, there's probably a couple of families living per apartment here, sharing the expenses of the apartment. But I don't think, yeah, most of the Mexicans, you know, a lot of them aren't registered Americans or legal Americans, so, or they call them undocumented, so that they can't get any government help. You know, maybe if their children were born here, they can get some food stamp money. But yeah, they won't get any subsidized housing if they're you know, not documented. Yeah, well, they're afraid of immigration. You know, immigration has been stepping up lately. You know, and if anybody gets pulled over or any type of you know, legal infraction, they're you know, sending them back to Mexico. So people are very wary right now of you know, of anybody strange. You know.
Okay.
Yeah.
After coming here, I've developed a new website for Tent City, and I maintain its Facebook page. Well, until now, most people knew about Tent City from the local media outlets, which weren't always very friendly. Through the website, we're trying to put out our own voice and you know, cover things from our perspective. And you know, the website reaches out to people for different kinds of things. You know, it's for you know, just news and happenings related to Tent City. It's ways they can help.
I'm gonna come back with blankets, pillows, coolers.
Okay, great.
All right.
Okay,
so
beautiful.
God bless.
Well, this time of year it starts to pick up. So summer is the hardest for the camp. Let's say July and August are the slowest months for people donating. Then when September comes and kids go back to school, it picks up, and then it really picks up from November to December, Christmas time. I was working for a high voltage electrical contractor doing work in the Lincoln Tunnel, the Holland Tunnel, the George Washington Bridge, and then coming home at night and going out to the woods and bringing sleeping bags and, you know, propane in the winter time, you know, doing whatever I could to help them out. And then after a while, I realized I couldn't do both. I couldn't keep my job working up in New York City and then come down to, you know, come down here and go out into the woods at nighttime all over the place and meet the needs of the homeless. So I decided to leave my job and started doing this full time. Let's go ahead and open up with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank thee for another day that thou hast given us the breath of life, another day to enjoy the beauty and wonders of thy great creation. Father, we just ask that thou would continue to help us in Tent City, even as thou hast already done. Father, we see thy faithfulness and thy kindness toward those, Father, in need. Father, here in Tent City, we see the real intangible ways in which thou dost care for the poor and the needy. We get pizza every day. A fellow by the name of Tim, he meets me out at the road at 5 o'clock in the morning. He goes around to about 10 pizza parlors at the end of the day. Whatever they've got left over and they didn't sell, is still on their shelf, they donate, you know, to Tim or to the homeless here. And so Tim picks it up, and then he goes and he sleeps on the road. He's homeless himself, lives in his car, and it's all he does all day long is he takes people to the doctor. He'll pick up from bakeries, deliver to pantries, and he does this all on his pension check. He sleeps in his car and spends his money on helping people all day long. Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah, I've never seen a higher degree of self-sacrifice than with this. He's a two-tour Vietnam combat vet too.
Marvelous, simply marvelous. Thank you. Thank you very much. And
I love it. And so I believe the words of the Bible. I believe there's eternal life. So that's what I'm investing in. In other words, it's mine because I believe it. And so what I've got here, I can use to help other people because I don't have to attain anything here. This is just an investment for what's to come.
It's a weird one down. We got it's a thriller.
He's happy because all I do is wake up and just get me a bowl of cereal milk. Because before I used to ask him for like all types of food, and now I'm just like.
See that cravings. I like to get up 2 or 3 in the morning and go grill a hamburger. Where am I getting a hamburger from?
Day-day.
Day-day. Y'all can't go in that cooler now. I need a burger. I ain't gonna get no sleep tonight.
You ain't getting no sleep then.
If somebody's hungry in Tent City, they want to be hungry. Yeah. Not because they don't have enough food.
But most of the people, they don't clean up. You clean up also?
Yeah. I'm hoping that by example they would learn a lesson. But again, it's typical. You know, the path of least resistance. Whatever is easier, you know, that's tendency with human beings, you know, that the human nature is just to find the easiest way out a lot of times. If somebody else is willing to do the work, let them do it. So, you know, I don't mind doing it, but it's, you know, short term. This tent city is not going to be forever because, you know, the townships are closing it down, and then we're going to go to another phase.
By the time this year is over, I hope to be in my apartment.
But it's for a
by
year,
November.
Right?
Yeah, for 1 year. When that year is up, hopefully I'll be gainfully employed and I'll be able to be self-sufficient, you know, back on the right track so I can afford to take care of, you know, my family. That's the goal. That's another picture of him.
Well, my other kid is not with me, unfortunately. But he's in foster care, and my concerns with kids, I love kids, and I pretty much, to all the kids out there, like, I was in foster care myself, but there is hope out here, and I just want all the kids to know that, you know, I'll be continuing to fight for all the kids out there, including mine, and never give up on hope.
Another wonderful day.
Have a good day, Steve.
Okay, have a good day, guys.
Romantic. We fight over it all the time. Who gets to make the fire? Who makes the best fire? And of course you know who makes the best fire, don't you?
Well, now you said it, I didn't. You said it right there, you know.
I said, you'd think we wouldn't be busy, but we're busy all the time. Too busy. Because, you know, it's very hard work, you know, every little thing you do is work, you know. If I need to wash dishes, I have to heat water, I have to get water because all the water's frozen, you know. Very hard work. Yeah, we have one daughter, she's in her 40s already. We've got 3 grandkids. We pretty much lost touch there. We haven't talked to them in years now.
Although I wasn't there.
Really, we haven't talked to anybody since we came here except I did talk to her daughter till I found out that she dumped all our stuff.
All my paintings, like I say, all Michael's music, music books. We had an organ, everything. When we came here, we weren't sure we would stay. We brought the necessities.
Oh, no, not me. I never lost control.
This house of learning, okay? Because on my free time, I like to study. So it's the unofficial house of learning. This is my desk. This is where I do my reading. Study books here. A lot of it is biblical, you know. I'm not like a religious freak or a religious fanatic, but a lot of the stuff that I study is biblical. Also mathematics and physics. I'm into quantum physics. Currently, I'm studying for myself. It's just I consider knowledge is the best use of your time. So just gain as much as you can. This is like a gingerbread house. It's the cutest house in Tent City. It's definitely the most well-maintained. They put a lot of effort into it. They have, it looks like a candy house, doesn't it? Like something from a storybook. They made their own street. What does it say? One Paradise Lane. It's just people that are trying to live, you know? They're making the best of a bad situation.
We've been battling the township for 3 years now. Since 2010, they took us to court. They sued us. The township of Lakewood sued the homeless to get us off the land. And a lawyer stood up on our behalf. A very strong lawyer. I belong to a very powerful lawyer firm. They spent over $1.5 million representing us. And so we kind of reached a compromise that what we would do is we would take a year's worth of housing. That's what's supposed to be happening, but what the township is doing is trying to figure out any way they can to disqualify the people down in Tent City. So it's been a half a year since that court case, since the consent order was signed, but nobody has gotten housing through the township. The other night, we experienced the worst harassment from the police in the township that we've ever experienced up to this time. They came in and they started ticketing people, giving people tickets for burning their wood stoves.
You gotta extinguish that fire. Any wood burning in here is not allowed anymore by township ordinance.
Well, I sat with the mayor 3 weeks ago, and the mayor said that we were exempt to that.
No, not anymore.
This gets depressing, you know? You have to deal with this. It's not easy. I mean, we're all, this morning is a good day. We're all smiles, got a cup of coffee, you know, and everything's good because God, you know, woke us up this morning. But some days, you know, the devil doesn't take a day off, so he can depress you into thinking that it's never gonna get better.
No. Right now I have no other options. All I have is Tent City. I have no other house, no apartment, no other options. I'm totally homeless. I'm totally like anybody else in Tent City. If the township closes down Tent City, I've got no place to go. My parents were very giving and self-sacrificing. So I think I picked up those traits from my parents and, you know, also my religious beliefs also. Okay, fantastic. I'll be coming. Okay. Thanks. Bye-bye. I feel much more fulfilled, much more satisfied, much more complete as a human being reaching out to other people. But I'll tell you one thing. God is in the boat. God is in the boat. And God's not going to let it end the way that the township thinks that it's going to end. Because God is about justice. God is about fairness. God is about equality. God is about the principles that the founding fathers of America spent so much time and concern in addressing the fairness of a good society. Yet they'll criticize some other country for their human right violations. In my book that's called Hypocrisy. My book that's called Injustice or Duplicity.
But it's all right. It's all right. We live so well. help it, I wonder what's gone wrong.
Lakewood, New Jersey, USA, and what's going on in this town is really quite unique in that there's a major, what we call gentrification. One group of people is moving into the town and getting the lion's share of the housing. What it is this new community is going in and they're buying up the homes, but they're buying it up with recycled taxpayer dollars. See, the tenant belongs to this group, but also the landlord belongs to this group also. So the welfare money that goes to a pay for their apartment goes back to the landlord in the same group. So that money stays within their community and is just recycled. And so what's happening here is they're buying up the rest of the community with taxpayer dollars. And so basically what it is the person living in that home is paying taxes. He's paying for his home to be bought up by this new group. It's just not right. It's wrong, and the politicians are allowing it because the new population has a voting block, and they vote as one organized group. And so come election time, all the politicians want those thousands of votes on their side. So they look the other way. What they're doing in Lakewood is illegal. It's wrong, it's unethical, but the politicians look the other way because they want the votes of this voting bloc.
Steps Office. This is the organization that's solutions to end poverty soon. That's what STEP stands for. It's like a stepping stone to, like, for people that are a paycheck from homelessness to keep them, prevent them from becoming homeless. You know, I was working with Mike before I became homeless, but, you know, sometimes with certain employment situations and court situations, you slip through the cracks. I was one of those people that slipped through the cracks. So we're, like, trying to redefine what my problems are now and come up with a solution. That's why they call it Solutions to End Poverty Soon. I guess we'll go inside.
Good morning. And I think, I don't know if we filled out an application on it or not, but I'll give you the paperwork to fill an application out on that, and we'll keep that open for you. So, but, you know, like, we're gonna meet with Social Services because, like I said, that we're willing to split the bill with them because they're paying for your housing now, so it would make more sense to take you out of the motel because it's costing more for you to live in that motel than it would for us to put you in housing. So I'm going to see if we can work a deal out with them. They've been working very close with us, okay?
Yeah, you're a good salesman. I know you're doing well.
Thank you for that one. I appreciate that. But I want you to understand, we don't just help the people in Tent City. We help anybody that needs help. So tell your friend to just give us a call, and we'll take care of him, okay?
All right,
you got it. Okay, bye-bye.
If Social Services were putting these people up in hotels, they spend $1,500 a month per person just to put them in a hotel room. So they spend $1,500 per person. So if you calculated that, you know, times 12, times 80 people, which we, you know, have here, in fact, we have over 80 people a year, it's about $1 million a year that the government spends on housing 80 homeless people in hotel rooms. So housing people up here, that's about my monthly budget is $1,500 for 80 people. So we're saving the government a lot of money by, you know, creating a system like this. There's a lot of government waste. That's all taxpayer money. That's all, people paying their taxes are going to waste. They're wasting taxpayer dollars.
It's probably the hardest thing that I've ever had to do in my life. This was hard because the public, the average person doesn't see what has to be done.
You know, there's a court order saying that, you know, people have to be put up. So most people think that, oh, wow, you just take and you, you know, put people up. But these people, they have different issues. And sometimes, you know, you might run across somebody that's Megan's Law or somebody that's have been in jail for murder or whatever it may be, you know, drug addiction or people selling drugs, alcoholics. You know, all of those type of things that you have to deal with. And how do you deal with it? You know, what do? You just take all of those people and just put them in somebody's neighborhood? You know, no. You know, you have to find the right spot for that person.
You know, I thought that there was 4 animal shelters in Ocean County that were funded by the government, or at least partially funded by the government. But I find out now there's 7 animal shelters in Ocean County, this county, and we don't have any shelters for human beings in this county. You know, they'll put people up in a hotel for a year, and that's it.
Singing in the rain, just singing in the rain.
That's not you're gonna do it, right?
Yeah.
Hey, this is the guy you gotta talk to.
Let him tell his story. A week ago, he was telling me.
A week ago, I was saying how I was thinking I'm never gonna get out of Tent City, and today, in one fell swoop, got a place to live, went and saw it. Monday, I'll be out of here with my dog.
The township has been quite aggressive lately. I think what they were doing is they wanted to wait for the wintertime to see how many people they could weed out in the wintertime. See, you know, how many people they can wouldn't make it through the winter with the cold weather, you know, that might have an option. So I think that's why they wait until now to try to really, you know, start housing people.
As you see, I don't know if you know, but we've been pulling
got about 55 people out of here. I hear
people say we couldn't do it.
You're doing a good job, bro.
Thank you.
All right.
People say we couldn't do it.
Tuesday after 10?
You got it.
All right.
Okay. Oh, this is amazing, you know. People said we weren't going to be able to do this, you know. And but what they forgot about is that I work in the courts. You know, I go to court all the time. I meet all the landlords in the county. So over the, you know, several years, the landlords all got to really know me. And they've given me a lot of breaks, you know, in putting people up. And I really got to thank the landlords because, as you well may see, there's a lot of different issues out here with people. So the landlords, only thing they ask from me is that if there's an issue, that the landlord can call me and I can try to mediate the issue. I mean, and that's what I try to do, you know. So that helps us a great deal. That's how we're getting a lot of people out.
See, Mickey, we've got lots of dandelion. Look. That's a dandelion.
Wow. Oh, yeah. Well, holy smokes.
Over there.
Amazing. That's actually dandelion. Isn't that too much?
Yes, yeah, there's a lot.
So that's edible?
Yeah.
It actually looks like dandelion in the store.
Yeah.
Wow. Isn't that amazing? Too much. That's dandelion, too. Forget it, Whole Foods. Who needs ya?
We're taking everything for granted so quickly now. Although I must say, I do miss our stove. Don't you miss our stove a bit? A little bit?
No, that's because I was the one who sat up all night making the fire.
Well, I was the one who got most of the wood.
Yeah, but man. I was, you know, I was saying somebody 65 getting up at 12, at 2, at 4 in the morning. A 12-year-old wouldn't want to get up at 12 and 2 and 4 in the morning. You know, people are a lot younger, so, you know, to tell you the truth, it's nice to sleep through the night.
It's taking me a while to get used to having a stove. I burned a number of things because it's just different. Thank you.
in my living room.
Oh, Monique doesn't want to be filmed, no?
No, not today. She's not filming well. We had a beautiful baby girl, Destiny Diamond.
Diamond?
Yes. Right now, she's in foster care. Yeah. Like a foster family, the state commissions a foster family to take care of your child. If I guess you get a year to prove that you're a good parent. If you don't, they can adopt your kid. Like right now, we have to have supervised visits, like an hour a week. You know, which is kind of sad, because we like to spend more time with a child, you know?
Monique, if she wants to keep her baby, could give up crack and the like. But she won't do it. How much does she want to keep her baby? Am I being, you know, insensitive to ask that?
She already has four kids in care already. This is her fifth baby. And they take them away from her every single time.
And sort of for the government to take away that child from the person that, you know, has those inherent instincts to take care of that baby and then to give that baby to somebody else just doesn't seem the most efficient, you know, and proper and ethical way to handle the situation. You know, I think do whatever you can to, you know, help that mother do what she can to be, you know, to be the proper mother. I would hope and wish for them that, you know, Will and Mo would be able to get their baby back. But personally, you know, I don't believe it's going to happen.
You can be on Wall Street and be an alcoholic and a heroin addict and a cocaine addict. But if you got a lot of money, you can get away with it. So, and not only get away with it, but you can be sanctioned by the authorities because you have power and you have money. So it's not necessarily a problem of the poor. You know, it's rampant throughout the society, throughout the culture.
Well, as you can see, it never ends. But there is a light at the end of the rainbow. Or later than the tunnel, I should say. Like, I'm confusing metaphors. My record is over 18 years old, and it keeps popping up on the internet like I just committed the offense.
Oh.
I need help.
So you had an offense?
I had an offense, yeah, okay. But it's 18 years old. I'm eligible for an expungement.
No, and that's what we're trying to help you do. We're trying to help everybody get their life back, but it's just so many people, so many crises out here, it's very hard, you know?
Most agencies, most employers, when they go through it, use a temporary agency, they ask, as a prerequisite, do you want someone that has a criminal record? And most people opt to say no. They don't want to, they're not willing to give convicted felons a second chance in the community, even after they've paid their dues and their debt to society. They still have a stigmatism that haunts them and follows them. And it makes me unemployable. So it's very difficult to get what I need, you know, as far as putting food on the table for my family. You know, I don't want to be on welfare. I would like to go out and work a 9-to-5 every day, you know, and provide for my family like I'm supposed to.
It's a moment of truth here. We eat or we don't eat. We live or we don't live. The state decides. That's not you. Get out.
I wanted to get a photo ID so we can open a bank account. And I just,
I don't have my Social Security card and I can't get a new one, even though I have all this stuff coming from Social Security. I don't understand it.
Can you believe these monsters, Alexi?
I mean, they're giving me money.
A birth certificate, a marriage license, a copy of the Social Security card, a letter from Social Security which says it's legally official, proof of address, a utility bill. Oh, no. That's not good enough.
Why do I need to open the bank account right now?
Because our grant money came in a check. We can't deposit the check anywhere, so we can't use the money because it's just a check. I mean, any sensible person could see that I am me, but it's not good enough.
So basically, you're not you right now, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, this is an aspect of being homeless. We couldn't get any documentation because we didn't have an address, you know, so we're still struggling with the repercussions of that. What can I tell you? You know, this is bureaucracy at work.
Place.
Nice.
Where's my money?
Because, yeah, I was like, I can't leave him here.
Yeah. So I'm happy. You're happy. And
we're all
should,
happy.
You should see the place, though.
It's nice. He got really nice furniture.
Yeah.
The head of the organization, let's see, Steps Towards Ending Poverty Soon. that's the day. How soon? 2 weeks, 5 weeks, 2 years, 10 years. He says they're gonna make homelessness a crime. So they're gonna lock all the homeless people up. So that's a good solution, right? You know. The taxpayer pays a lot more money than for work programs and training programs, rehabilitation programs. For affordable housing, which is possible, you know, the affordable housing is possible. They could build affordable housing. They choose not to do it. You know, they choose to build
jails.
Yeah, they'd rather build jails. They can make more money off of jails.
Complain. Oh. They all have to be locked up or they kill each other. It's all right, Deja Vu. It's all right.
So they fight all the time?
Like maniacs. Like you can see, he's lost an eye. Deja Vu almost lost an eye. But if I catch it in time, usually I can save their eye. But sometimes I can't.
It's a dead end, and it proves to be a dead end. There were a number of deaths at Tent City, all due to overdoses and mixing alcohol with drugs and heroin overdoses that could have been prevented. The gentleman who died in the fire, he was constantly drunk. He lived 100 feet away from us. Marilyn saved his life twice about fires. And yet, nothing was done to deal with the situation. You know, to put him in a safer place, to have things that were more constructive, you know, activities that were more constructive.
I came out here today because I still haven't received any food stamps. And I'm trying to get something to eat for my family. So I came out here, Minister Steve looks out for me, gives me provisions. A little cat food for my cat, a little kitty litter, and a little bread and butter. I miss the eggs and everything else. So. But no complaints.
There are people that, you know, are so used to being out here, getting that help, and, you know, don't want to do for themselves. I understand that, you know, we're not gonna put everybody in a house and they're gonna like it. No, because they're going to want to come back out here where they can get food and get clothing and get all the free stuff. But see, I think that sometimes doing that is bad because, you know, folks sometimes they need to earn that. You know, like, for instance, if you look around here, you know, it could be cleaned up a lot better. So there needs to be some structure in, you know, work as you go along, you know. So if they work, you know, you get paid, you know. There need to be some type of system to do that, to make that happen.
This one here, too.
I think it was too much for Steve to do all by himself, you know. But it's hard to get people involved. Steve kind of is the type who doesn't like to have interference, you know, so it was tricky. I mean, I remember when we first came there, right away I said to him, well, what kind of jobs, you know, assign us some jobs. Everybody here should have a job, and he wouldn't hear of it. But really, that's how it should have been. Everybody, I would have liked to have been like the sanitation inspector.
You know, America has created, I believe, to some degree, this entitlement mentality where people believe the government has a responsibility to support them, you know, to take care of them. It's somebody else's responsibility to feed them or to house. And, you know, I mean, to a degree, there's something there. You know, if somebody's disabled or somebody can't take care of themselves, the society, you know, should have the humanity to be, you know, to take care of them. But on the other hand, you know, there's a responsibility of individuals to contribute to the society, contribute, you know, to their needs and to the needs of the society. Yeah, I believe according to the consent order, I've got to take another look at it, but I believe that the camp is, you know, allowed to stay open for another year. In case somebody loses their housing, they can come back to Tent City for a temporary space of time until they can get new housing. So I believe the camp will stay open for another year, even after the last person is housed, according to the consent order.
We're still deciding where to put all the sticks. There's sticks. It makes me really sorry about the stove because I wouldn't have to go far for sticks, that's for sure. Well, these are birds. Some of them aren't injured. They all came to us, and so we take care of them because they came to us. We're vegan. We don't eat animals. We don't eat eggs. But we take care of them. They're our companions and friends, and we do our best for them. I really think that they shouldn't be rehousing people for a year. They should find some other land and just start the Tent City over again, you know, because as hard as it is, and it is hard to live there, it's better than what's gonna happen to them, you know. At the end of a year, they're gonna have nothing. It upsets me very much, because, you know, you get used to living indoors and then you're gonna be stuck with nothing all over again. It's stupid.
Some of the folks that we've already put up, they do not have those survival skills because they're asking for certain things to get done. You know, they want somebody to come in and do them, and it shouldn't be. And I say to them, you know, you gotta make that telephone call. You gotta call there. I said, if you have a problem, then you call us, then we'll get involved. So these are the type of things that we're trying to teach them, you know, out there. You know, I know people are going to come and, you know, bring, you know, lots of food and lots of clothing and all of that stuff. Yes, it's needed for some people, but some people it's not. Some people, you know, we want them to, you know, learn to survive, that they have to get out here and get a job. If they don't get a job, they don't have, you know, SSI or SSD or general assistance or anything like that. So, yes, this is about survival. This first year is going to be survival training.
bad taking, you know, doing this to Hannah, but you know, dumped her anyway.
Eventually, you know, we'll be closed, this tent city. But there always will be some type of tent city somewhere, because where are the people gonna go? So don't anybody ever think that there's not gonna be a tent city. There might not be a tent city in this particular spot, but I guarantee you, as long as, you know, our government continues not to recognize that we have issues, you're always gonna have tent cities.